Welcome to our Deck the Halls project. My name is Patricia Rawlinson and this is Rudolph. And what we've got going on here is a rock lawn banner that doesn't fray, so you can cut out at the top and the bottom. We've got a magneted on nose that just has a magnet on the back side so that you can stick it wherever you want to. You can move it, take it off, which is the best part, so that when you're storing it, it just stores nice and flat. We've got a topper up here and we've taken advantage of the glistening snow rider, and we've dripped snow coming off the edge and on Rudolph's antlers. When you see it in person, it looks really cool because it's just very dimensional. We've also used the new Glamour Dust Ultra Fine Glitter Paints. What I love about these is the glitter doesn't come off the project, so you can have sparkles and shiny, but it's not going to litter down in, you know, in your entry or anything like that. The banner, we've also taken advantage of the new embellishments that we've got. So we've got embellishments on both sides. And have painted them to go with, and it just adds that dimensional kind of effect. I think that you're going to enjoy the project. It's definitely a lot of fun. Okay, I'm using the yellow tracing paper that's 24 inches long. It comes on a roll. It has a grain that runs in both directions, and it that means it'll tear. Whoops, where are we? There we are. It'll tear straight in either direction. Let's get you back a little bit. Okay, so it'll tear pretty straight in either direction that you need it to, and I'm not going to tear that side because I need it. I've got a banner that's fairly long, and I want to have extra room for playing with my placement, so I'm going to allow a little extra room down at the bottom. And you can see how nice and clear this tracing paper is. It's got a slight yellow cast, which makes it more transparent than the white. And so we're going to use a pen sticks pen to trace our pattern. And this is a 0.5. They come in different thicknesses. That's a pretty good thickness. And what I like is it doesn't bleed through and it doesn't run. So I'll just trace my pattern and then I'll be ready to transfer my pattern on. All right, when doing my layout for something that's long, like this little reindeer guy, I'm going to balance out. I'm going to find out where the two patterns meet, basically. They're not completely balanced. I'm going to fold my paper in half. Okay, and then, you know what, let's see. We want his nose to be fairly middle. So I'm going to line up his eyes instead. And he should basically sort of match mostly. Okay. And then we'll fold it again, getting us to the end of our piece. And we're going to want to make sure that this is straight. Okay, so I'll measure it with a ruler. Okay, now this gives me some kind of centering lines, okay? Folding your paper is the easiest way to make sure that things are doing what you need them. Now, when I'm going up here with this part of my, the Deck the Halls part of stuff, then what I want to do is I want to make sure that I've got these in the center. So I'll fold this and then place it in my middle line. I'm going to use rock lawn, which is a drapery lining fabric. this is the banner or the table runner length because we have a pretty long banner here. So I will put this on top of here and I'll use my straight edge to give myself a nice crispy little edge. And you could center it too and then make your mark. You want to go ahead and cut yourself a little bit extra on either end. And then what this is, for this guy right here, this is where it'll be placed when it flaps over. So let me hold this under. Okay, so when I've got this there, I've got to allow for that much extra. So that is how many inches? Okay, just use a T-square. So it is like five, we'll call it 5.5 inches extra over and above the length of the banner. And so I will move this down, allow for the 5.5 inches, and then cut my longer banner. Make sure you cut it long enough to have that flap over. Now you never want to presume that when you get a piece of cut rock lawn that you've got a straight edge. And even if you get it from the factory, you don't want to presume that. I'm going to use my T-square. I want a square banner to start with, okay? I'm going to get it kind of centered where I think I can make a cut. I'm going to use my triple threat ghostwriter. Doesn't matter which side you're marking on. You can mark on the side you don't want to paint on. And then you're going to measure to go across. So I'll start my measure right on that line. I love see-through tools. Okay, we're going to go right here to 11. And I probably should make, let's see, that'll reach. I think that'll reach. So we'll make our mark. And then we'll do the same thing here. We'll measure down. I came up with 28 and a half inches long is how long I'll need that. So I'll do this, make my mark, go down, measure 28 inches, tee up to the other, or L-square up the other side, and start cutting. As I'm looking for the right color, there's a fairly limited selection of blues in the DecoArt palette, but what I wanted to show you, I've made little cards for each of my colors, but some of these colors of paint, like this is Ultra Blue Deep, okay? This is that color right there. And then if you've added white down the edge, this is what colors you can come up with. And over here is if you've added like black to it, okay, or gray, sorry. So you come up with a big variety of different toned colors, and each of the blues will make a different kind of color. So it's really a neat little exercise to do. Then you can see, maybe I need a color like over here. You can see that I have ultra and primary blue, okay? Or I've got primary blue only over here plus white. So you can make yourself some little recipe cards. You can put little notes on them. It makes it really, really handy. This book is tremendous. I keep colors that are discontinued, but I can just flip through it to get a real idea of what the colors look like. And then the ones that are the pure pigment colors, I've gone through and done my little exercise in mixing and stuff. Oh, and the pages that these are in, these are baseball card pages that you can get at the office store. And I've just got a little piece. They're on the back of white business cards, or business cards with white backs. And I put a little piece of black cardstock or whatever cut behind it. That way I don't get the colors. I've got a couple pages that don't have that. And you get a little bit messy with the colors behind. So I do like it with the black better. Okay, it's time to paint our rock lawn. You don't have to prep rock lawn in any way. You can choose to paint on the canvasy kind of texture side or the smooth side. I almost always paint on the canvasy textured side. I don't have a reason. You can paint on both, and I've done it. But I do like the canvasy side better. I'm going to use a roller, and we're going to use this black nonstick craft mat, and that is going to keep the paint like mess on the mat, and it can be wiped off easily after, so I don't have a lot of cleanup to do. Just a little squirt with water. We'll wipe off with the paper towel. Okay, so we're just going to roll on a nice, even, thin coat. With rock lawn, you always want to put thin coats, okay? If you put thick coats, then you're going to get curling and other problems. So thin coats that you repeat is perfect. And it has a tendency to grab on the edge and then roll up into the roller. So I always roll towards my edge when I am prepping. Okay, and then I'm going to do two coats. And you'll see there's some kind of like dry areas when you're doing it. Definitely have to have two coats. You can go ahead right now while you've got the color out and paint the back side. And we're using winter blue. I'm going to store the roller in a baggie so it won't dry. If air doesn't touch the roller, then it won't, then the paint won't dry, because it's actually an oxidizing process with air. And that's how paint dries. Okay, so we're going to clean this up. I'm going to mist it with water. We're going to use our little handy scraper. And this little guy is handy dandy. Okay, it's not my painting quite dry. So it's not really scraping, it's just kind of smearing. But that's okay. Now I've actually got a couple of these mats taped together to have a bigger painting surface. I love not having to clean or change my paper on my table all the time. And I love that it's waterproof. I love that nothing sticks to it. I love that I didn't clean up after the last project. Okay, so we just clean it up, dry it off, of course smear the paint around. And we'll give it one more little mist since it was all wet paint. Who knew that it was harder to clean up wet paint than dry paint? Okay. Love having that nice, clean, ready-to-go surface. And I know that I'm not going to have a bunch of stuff getting on the back of my project that way, too. Okay, so my My first coat is about dry. It's still a little bit cold. But what you'll notice is you'll get just a little bit of raising nap of some sort. And it's not really a nap, but it's like, I don't know what it is. It happens with primed canvas and it happens with floor cloth as well. So let's go ahead and just give it a light sanding. We're not trying to sand the texture off. We're just trying to make sure we don't have any raised paint. And you shouldn't need to do that again. And just that very, very lightest sanding will do this. Okay, and yeah, that's perfect. So it's just so faint, I'm not even getting any dust. I don't know what makes it happen, but I do know that it's very common. We once had a floor, I had a class full of people painting floor cloths, and some kinds of the canvas were doing a really bad job, and once we knocked back that texture, then the class went on, and it was very, very awesome, but boy, the students were really struggling with that extra little bit of texture that raised up. Okay, when you have a rather long piece like this to trace, it can be a really great idea to do this great little trick. You just cut a hole where there's no pattern in two places on your project. Let's look for another place, huh? Go over here. And you get it lined up how you need it. Okay, and his ears go about side to side here. And a little bit more room for my cutout at the bottom. Make sure that I have enough flap. And then what we'll do is we'll take two pieces of scotch tape and we'll just tape right through the hole. And what this does for us is your pattern won't shift. If you tape just in one spot at the top, then you can get shifting. But this way, you can't shift your pattern. And what you do to trace is you just simply lift and you put your paper around. And you want to use the Triple Threat Ghost Rider because it has the roller ball and the padded grip. So it makes tracing patterns very, very comfortable. Okay, as I'm getting ready to clean, as I'm getting ready to paint, if I put this over the top of here, you can see that I have, with my acrylic bridge, I have been a pig. So what I've got, I tested the brush cleaner and restorer, and I've just got it on a paper towel, and you can go on here and you can totally just clean off your paint and it doesn't affect the plastic. So I can clean my paint off and restore my poor little paint bridge here. You just dry it off and buff it, and you could wash it if you don't want your hand running through that stuff. But it cleans it super quick and easy. And it's even taking off things like glitter paint and stuff like that I can see that I've been messy and gotten on here. Okay, the reason I want my brush, my artist bridge, is because I want to roll up my rock lawn, and I don't want to put my hand on it and flatten that. Because if you flatten it, then it'll get creases, and then if you crease it, then it's not good, and so I want to make sure that I don't get any creases, so I'm just going to keep it rolled up nice and tiny, and then I'll use my bridge over the top of it so that I can still get in there and work where I want to. And I'm just doing the base coats. They're all listed in the instructions. This one is kind of base coat intense, so just follow the list in the thing and get it all ready to go, and we'll have fun with all the details. All right, getting ready to stipple the wreath. And I've got an angle stippler that has natural bristles in it, and I let it soak for about 5 minutes. If you don't let it soak, then the bristles will just kind of be normally just kind of stiff and inanimate, kind of. And then we're going to smash this brush open. I mean, really smash it open. Work at it. Okay? You're not going to really hurt it. You want it to be open and stipply. Okay? Add just a little bit more water than I had. Blot on your paper towel to get it right consistency. Really, just really smash it open. And get our project over here. And I'm going to just, a little too open. I'm going to just stipple here and there where my greenery is and wreath. And you want to turn your brush so that you're not aiming the same direction all the time. Go over your things that are in the way, like go over his head and all that, and then we'll go back to those and give it their second base coat. I see how that's giving a nice wreathy kind of a look. And pick up more of the wet, smashing your brush while you do it. I've got my pattern on here so faint I almost can't see anything. It's kind of what you want, but I think I've exceeded sheer here. Let's see, I've got my picture over here so I can see kind of how far down it goes, because I can't tell on my pattern. Okay, and I think it's a little bit distant back here, so I'm going to go ahead and thicken that up. Okay. And now we'll go into a little bit more straight paint, less water. And let's go ahead and give some texture. Might have to wait till that dries. Let's see. Make sure you cinch up right next to those the bow and stuff. And now I'll rebase coat and allow that to dry. And so this is what the bridge is for. So I can work on base coating while this is drying, which will take a little bit to dry. And I don't have to worry about running my arms through stuff. I'm going to use the Graceful Snowflake stencil. And I'm going to use Tack It Over and Over, which will make this tacky and like a big post-it note. I'm going to use my jumbo dauber, and I'm going to pounce off on my palette because you don't want it applied really thickly. And I find it best just to go ahead and do the whole stencil when I do this because it just makes the mess once, and I always use Tack It on my stencils because I don't like stencils to bleed under, and this just stays and doesn't go away, and it's just awesome. There's, like, I can't think of a reason to do it except for they do stay sticky, but like, that's the whole idea, right? So I'll just get this evenly coated, and you want it thinner rather than heavier, especially when we get into these delicate stencils, because they, then you can rip stencils if you get it on too thick. So you want to do, be careful, apply it thin so that you just have delicate tack instead of heavy tack. Okay, do peel your stencil off, and then just fold your wax paper over and lay it gently on top, and that will prevent it from adhering to that. Let it dry till it's clear, and you'll be ready to use it. Okay, now we're going to sprinkle snowflakes on. I want to get them on before I start putting the shine of my lights on and stuff like that. And I'm going to put out a little bit of the Glamour Dust Ice Crystals Fine Glitter Paint, because while I've got my stencil on here, I'm going to go ahead and glitterify it. Okay, so I fell in love with this little guy right here for this, and a couple of these round-shaped ones. And what I want to do is I want to avoid his antlers. So I'm going to stipple with the dome brush, and I'm going to blot it off on my paper towel because this is really delicate stencils. I'm still going to make a little bit of a mess on my antler, which is fine. And we'll just get it white. And you can check, you know, to see how the coverage is doing. Okay, make sure you're squished back down. You could do it a couple of times for stronger stencils. Whatever you like, that's what you do. Okay, now what I'll do is I'll blot my brush and I'll pick up the ice crystals and I'll pounce that onto. So the ice crystals isn't opaque, so we can't just go right on top unless I want sheer snowflakes. So I have to have something behind them. Okay, so then we have our first snowflake. Okay, and I do not like this snowflake because it's smeared. And why did it smear? Because I used the ice crystal on top and I didn't blot enough off. And I also did it while my white paint was wet, which made the clearness of the ice crystal made the wet paint smear. So off we go with the snowflake. Okay, so I'll wipe that off, and then I'll just give myself a little base coat, and I will do that one more time. It's never a problem with paint because you can always base coat. All right, here we go. We're going to do it again. We'll do it over here on this side, though. Okay, we're going to blot off. If we want our control, then we have to have very dry paint. Okay, and that's where we failed the last time. Snowflakes, I think, are so much prettier when they have that really precise edge. Okay, I'm going to leave that in place and I'm going to blow dry it. Repeat again. It may be that we don't get to have our white ice crystal on this. Let's see. Okay. Hit it with a blow dryer again. I've just got it sitting on my lap. And dry. All right, now let's see if we can do this. Now let's check it first to see if we're nice and solid. And we're very clean and clear. Okay. Now poke it all down. And I'm just going to go through the middle. Blah, blah, blah. See what we got now. Okay, that's much better. Now I'm going to sprinkle snowflakes around here and there. Okay. And I'm going to do them one by one with the ice crystal and the white. Okay, so we have, I'm going ahead and doing some little faint fuzzy snowflakes as well. Just a little bit of something back there. I think that it adds dimension. So just fill those skies with some that are really soft and some that are really strong. Okay, and then we can go back in and add like these ones that are big, like stars, here and there. And a couple clusters of dots. The dots are just a really magical little touch. You don't think about them being that way, but go ahead and add some in and you'll see what I'm saying. They just add just a sense of effervescence, kind of. Okay, and I'm just using stencils, the things within this stencil right here. I'm painting in my features just so that for design purposes, and then I wanted to share with you a cute trick for painting balls and things like this. You just put them on the end of a paintbrush and then you paint them, and hopefully by the time you get to the top and get two coats on it, then the bottom is dry and you can carry on, just take it off and put it onto your tabletop. Real super way to keep your hands clean. Okay, so we're going to take our big angle shader brush and Alizarin Crimson, and we're going to float around the base of Rudolph's nose and kind of walk it up in to his nose. But a pretty strong color, of course, because it's Rudolph's nose. Okay, dry that with a blow dryer. We're going to dry rub with a crescent stencil, crescent brush using coral blush. And we're just going to dry rub right there on the end of his nose, fading down. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm going to give him a shine that is kind of just like a circle over here. Nah, maybe we'll give it a little bit of a C-stroke kind of thing. Off to the side. Dry it with a blow dryer. Okay, then we're going to go into the white and a small tiny crescent brush. And we're going to make that white be shinier. Oops. Okay. Then we're going to go with our red, let's see, it's sizzling red glitter paint. And we're going to, it'll turn out being a glaze. The glitter paint ends up actually glazing things. So, and it's got glitter embedded, and the glitter doesn't fall off, which I love. Love, 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 love. So I'm doing it from the bottom up. That'll end up kind of glazing over our cute little highlight. I'll smooth it out. And we can re-put a highlight on there if we need to. Okay, and now we're going to have a big glittery Rudolphy nose, which is perfect. Okay, where I put my shine before, we'll go ahead and put our shine again. Okay, and now we have a Rudolph nose. Okay, I'm going to use these really strong magnets to attach, and they come together, they'll come in your kit, really, they'll be already attached. And you'll think that you can't pull them apart, my husband even thinks sometimes he can't pull them apart. But what you do is you just slide them in your fingers, and then you can get them apart. And they're super, like, super duper strong. Okay, so I want to glue them so that they, the magnetic side, the parts that want to make them stick together, if I turn them around, obviously they're going to polarize. So I want to make sure that I glue them on so that they are attracted to each other. I'm just going to use a little dot of hot glue on that, and then I'll make sure that I have the right side, and then I will attach the nose to the other side of the banner. All right, I've got my base coats done for my light bulbs and things like that. I'm going to take my angle shader again, and I'm going to tip into non-diluted plantation pine. And I'm going to go back through, and I'm going to darken and deepen the middle of my wreath. Now I can handle this stuff on my light bulbs and stuff like that one of two ways. I can just go ahead and wipe it off before it dries, or I could do the directions, which will you'll have in your hands, that will allow you to do them in the order that it should be painted. So I would just kind of do that. Sometimes this blocking in color gets a little bit messier than I think it should be. Okay, I like it better with the wreath, with the dark up the middle. Yeah. All right, I'm going to make the, I'm going to use my triple ghostwriter. This is a white ceramic lead. You twist it, there's a gray ceramic lead, and then there's that rollerball to trace. the white ceramic lead will erase with any kind of liquid or with an eraser, so spit, varnish, water, that kind of stuff. So I'm going to put my little veins on there so that I know which direction I'm going. And then I'm just going to float the highlight on. So we've already base coated basically our and done our heavy work. Our shadows are already there, is what I'm trying to say. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and give ourselves a highlight. And that is Hauser Light Green. And then, sneak in over here. And I'm not going to be able to sneak in on that very well. I'm wanting to come into just these corners. And we'll drag it along. I'm twisting my brush just a little bit. Need just a little bit more water. It's not wanting to float into the texture. Okay, now I'm going to float next to that with some plantation pine, but outside of that leaf. So I'm going to come up this side. And oops, and I don't have enough paint. Plantation pine is pretty transparent. Okay. And it doesn't matter if I get any on the other leaf because it is that color. So next we'll dry that and I'll show you the final technique for the leaves. I've got my brush. I got my small crescent brush loaded for Hauser Light Green. And I'm just going to extend my floats by dry rubbing. I've got dry paint, dry brush, and I dried it off on my paper towel. Load a little bit more. You just really just rub off everything that you can get off there. And then I'll go into my corners and just extend that float out just a little bit and clean up my corners. It's a real good cheater way of floating corners. Now I'll load into Limeade. Pardon the rough voice, my goodness. Load into Limeade and then do repeat in the lightest areas. And I'll switch to the microscopic little guy here for my corners. What I like about dry rubbing is it's a really friendly technique that even beginners can do. Because most of us know how to point a pen or a pencil in a direction and, you know, hit our mark. So as long as you can aim with a pen or a pencil and hit your mark, then you'll be able to do this technique. All right, so we're going to go with our liner brush and some Limeade and just give our leaves a little bit of sparkle. They're hard and shiny, you know, that the holly leaves. Okay. Every now and then I'm going to get lost in my artistic moment and I forget that I'm talking. All right, so all of these leaves are going to be done the same way. They're all repetition, so just go for it. All right, I'm going to go into... So what I'm not liking about these is that my lines are very liney all the way around. So what I'm going to do is go into Plantation Pine with a dry brush, and that means I'm going to load my brush with kind of juicy paint. I'm not scooping, I'm pressing it into my brush. I'm going to flick once on my paper towel. And then what I'm going to do is I'm just going to drag out, go around my berries, and I'm just going to drag out just a little bit of shadow that says I'm sinking into something. Okay? And so I'll just do that coming out of my berries and where things look like they need to be conjoined. And that should give me a little bit more depth. I think I might go into a little bit of black green as well. I think we need one layer deeper. Let's try that. And you gotta be careful because black green can be kind of a dark abyss, you know? Let's go to this one we just did. Go around it very, and then we'll tickle out that color. Okay, yeah, that's a little bit better. All right, the hot glue gun didn't stick my shiny metal to my nose. It did, and then when I tried to take them apart, it unstuck it. So what I'm going to do is I've got my quick grip. And I'm going to just, I've got it on my palette, instead of trying to put it on, I'm going to just kind of smudge it on there like that, keep it a little bit less messy, and then I'll put my magnet on there like that, and then I'll just balance this over here, and it's a little bit easier when you're trying to get just a little bit of glue out to put it on your palette and use an applicator or something like that. But I wanted to share the, it's very hard when you put out the glitter paints, it's very hard to see how shiny and crystally it is, but when it dries perfectly clear and allows all the shiny crystal to shine through and you can see it, and it's just really fun to kind of play with this little piece of plastic. But that's how nice and glittery, and here's the clear. And you can see how shimmery and how sparkly that is. Just enough to catch your eye, but not too much to be messy. All right, I'm going to use my drying time extender in a different way. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw it in the paint. Good. Okay. Lovely. So we're going to take the drying time extender and our half-inch size oval glaze. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it right along his face and his body. Okay. Okay, and make sure that you get it into those little grooves and cracks and crevices. You just need it right up next to it. Okay, and I don't need it near his ear, only where his furry part is. I'll get it on his antlers. And this is just going to dry clear. And but it's going to mask for us. So what it's going to do is give me the ability to kind of make a mess without having to clean up my mess. It's going to allow me to clean up my mess. Okay. I've got cocoa and sable brown mixed together over here on my palette. I'm going to use my oval texture brush. And I'm going to just kind of smunch all over it so I get a nice covering. Tap on my paper towel. Okay, and then I'm going to go right over the area that that I've got masked. Okay. And we'll march across his face. And what I'll do is I'll go back in with my already wet brush and I'll just clean it up. Clean it out of his ear. And just scrub that out and push it back. It can hang over his ear a little bit because after all it is fur. This is a really great way of cleaning and protecting your surface when you know you're about to make a mess. And then I'll continue. Okay, and we're going to march right across his face. You want to kind of connect your dots a little bit. I didn't bother doing his eyes because I could just quickly base coat them again. You can decide how furry you want him. Make sure you rock it around. You can come back through and do a little bit more. And then let's get them just a little bit lighter. Let's go with, let's try just cocoa in the middle. And just do just cocoa. Like maybe just cocoa all over the place. Now don't let this all go too long before you start fixing, correcting the, and then let's do one more light with oyster beige plus cocoa. And we'll mix that with a palette knife. It's just like one in one. On the ear, wherever he would be highest. A little bit more. And then you can soften your pressure. Like I just kind of boinked him right there in the middle of his nose. Softer pressure will get you a finer stipple. Good, and I'll hand wash this brush. This brush sitting in water would be a big mistake. So you just want to go ahead, and it actually can rust a little bit, so you just want to hand wash it and then just hang it to dry. It's got a little hole there, you can put a little hook in or a wire and hang dry. Because I waited so long, I'm going to go ahead with my little crescent brush or my large crescent brush and I'll just load my paint and scrub off any of my overage. And it is actually a really quick, easy cleanup. Just dip it into my retarder or extender and just clean that all off. Okay, we're going to switch to a smaller dome brush for the texture around his antlers. We're going to do the same technique. The reason we can use this small brush, and now what I'm going to need is my bridge to keep myself out of all the wet medium and stuff. So we couldn't use a small brush on his face because then you'd end up with little antlery or deer polka dots everywhere. You know, he'd be like a polka-dotted chicken pox Rudolph. We don't want that. So we'll just block him. And then we'll stipple. Alright, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to stipple into a bittersweet chocolate first. And really just kind of fill the top surface of my brush, blot it on the paper towel. And then I'll go over here and I'll just give him some nice, soft fuzz. I carry that all, oops, I didn't get that blocked out. Let's go over here. I didn't go around the corner here. This is a really amazing technique for those of you who make a mess and you want to know how to control it, which is what I do all the time. Okay, so we just get that nice all the way to the edge kind of fuzz going on right through our lights. Okay, antlers need to be a little furry. And then what we'll do is we'll dip into dirty brush, dip into Cocoa Plus. And I'm going to wipe my brush up better than that. And then dirty brush load. Cocoa Plus Asphaltum. And now this I'm going to put as a highlight right up the middle. And then we'll go into just a little bit of just plain cocoa. Gets a little bit, stripey, just kind of tap off over to each side. Okay, then we'll clean up our mess, and I think I want one more. I need something a little bit stronger. I need more texture. I'm going to go into our Italian sash brush and the cocoa. I'm really going to just pound it off over here. Okay, really just tap dancing. Tap on my paper towel, and I want texture, so I'm going to just set it down. It covers just about the whole antler, but it's going to be airy. See how much airier that is? Yeah, that's a little bit better. Okay, we're going to do a pretty big float of bittersweet chocolate in his ear. We're going to go right through our lights. You don't have to have your lights based until the end. Mine are based so that for design purposes I can see how things are going to flow and how they anchor. Okay, so we're just going to float right up next to where his ear drops in. And then we're going to cheat and dry rub and bring it out in a little bit. And bring it down his face, around to that corner. I don't know how much we'll need to. Maybe we'll just walk it out with this. When your colors aren't that different, it's easier to walk a float. Okay, so that just deepens and darkens his ear. And repeat on the other one. Okay, now I'm going to shade with Asphaltum and a wet, watery-handled brush. A little bit narrower on his antlers. So what we're going to do is a little more water here. When you're floating and you need a really crisp edge on rock lawn, because of its texture, you're going to need to have a little bit of extra water in your brush. So we'll come over here and we will shape next to and all the way around. We'll have to wait for one to dry to be able to get next to the edges on both. All right, we're going to seal our banner topper just to get this kind of in the same speed. While I have browns out, I want to work on my browns. Get the banner topper all sealed on both sides. Always seal your wood on both sides and the edges. And the way you would do the edges on something like this is you can use either the ink sweeper or a jumbo dauber, and then you just tap in place and you just go across. And that is a really good way to get it without any little bleeds. Okay, we're going to use cocoa and a crescent brush, and we're going to dry rub up the middle of our antlers. I'm looking to see what's wet. When you get into long projects like this, it is a good thing to have a place to rest your arms. Okay, and we'll go just dry rub, and what's neat is the texture will still show through, but it'll just have a little bit more of that highlight. You can rub over the streaky, liney part of your black. And then I think we'll go into just a little bit of the pebble as well. And we'll do that a little bit more up the middle. Okay, and that will give us our roundness. Make sure it stays a little fuzzy. You don't want a straight line, because straight lines mean that you're shiny. And you don't want shiny antlers on a little baby reindeer. We're going to dry rub in his ear on this lower side, starting about in the middle. Dry that off a little bit more. It starts coming off chalky. I've got cocoa, but I think I'm going to neutralize my brush with the asphaltum and then reapply cocoa. It had just a little bit of my pebble mix in my brush. So we'll bring that down. There's the ear. Okay, and I think that's about all we want to do. Otherwise his ears will start taking attention because they're very, very dark. All right, we're going to shade around Rudolph's head with asphaltum. Got a big brush, and we can draw that in with a dry rub if we decide that we need it, which we more than likely will. Okay, so that's just going to frame his head just a little bit. And then we can walk it out just a little. I think we're going to be better off dry rubbing. So just make sure your float's juicy enough to get to your edge. And then you're going to float along the around his mouth, under his eyes. Maybe not too much, you don't want it to look like a football player. Over the tops of his ears. And then around his head. And under his chin. Don't do around his little patch of neck fur, but do around the area there. Okay, down here at the bottom where he, I have paints rolling everywhere here. Keep yourself rolled up so you don't have catastrophes. Okay, down here at the bottom of his neck, where it comes into this heart stuff or this bow stuff, get your line on there. Okay, so I'm just dibbly dabbling, getting it in there. I've done the sides already. And then once you do that, go back in and round out any shapes that happened because of that. Because you don't want it to have a shadow and then a shadow and then a shadow with these like sharp lines. You just want it kind of smooth and rounded. So just round it out, and that'll be more pleasing. I'm going to take some water and some cocoa. And I'm going to take my number 4 round, the Easy Stroke round brush, and then I want to just make a line highlighting his ear. And just to kind of give that just a little bit more definition. I'm going to do the other side as well. going to shade his muzzle with Mississippi Mud. I can find a spot on my palette. Let's give him just a little bit of definition. Okay, and we're going to shade underneath his muzzle thing here. Mississippi Mud. I don't know that we can tell we did anything. That must be based with something with Mississippi Mud in it. Okay, and then we'll just make it go around and smooth it out. Okay, right now he looks so funny with that like light spot in his face, but when you put his nose on him, suddenly it changes everything and it makes it perspectively come out. I think we'll shade on his neck with a little asphaltum. Just go straight on under there. Give him a little definition. I think that's a little bit better. Put his nose back on. Okay, starting to look like Rudolph. Okay, I want to use a couple of colors. I'm going to use Pebble and probably some Mississippi Mud. Try making this look a little bit like it's fur, kind of coming down, but it's like silky fur. A little strong. Now I'll go into Mississippi Mud. Draw some of that out. Just using kind of the chisel of my brush. And then maybe we'll go into a little bit of the bittersweet for contrast. And we'll go into just a little bit of cocoa, maybe mixed with pebble. I can dig it. All right, we're going to use Pebble and our Italian sash brush and a little bit of oyster together, kind of stipple off on the paper towel. And then we're going to give his little nose. This is where we're going to have to be careful. We're probably going to have to do some cleanup, but I don't think it's going to be as drastic as the others. So what I'll do is when I'm going on the edge, I'll pinch my brush. Give him just a little bit of a furry face. I like the open texture that this gives. This is there, like I haven't found another brush. This is what I use to base coat the laser cut little pieces and stuff. And it just does a good job of getting where you want it, but it also makes just such an awesome even texture. Both of these, this and the texture brush have both been godsends. Okay, so I'm gonna add a little bit more of the oyster. Top of his muzzle and bring it down a little bit. Add his nose back in there and see how he's looking. Yeah, I think up near the top is good. Okay, I've added just a little line with the bittersweet chocolate for his mouth. Like he's going, oh, you know, oh no. Let's try widening it. I don't know if I'm going to benefit from that or not. the wider it gets, the more worried he gets, like, oh crap, I've done something wrong. Okay, we'll leave it at that. I'm looking to see what I like. Okay, I'll just leave it there. Okay, we're gonna float on his eyes, take his nose away. Same two. All right, get myself situated here. Same two sides with whatever color this is, I have no idea. I will tell you. Let's go across the bottom as well. And on the same other side, that is what color? Mississippi Mud. So I'll come across here and then up the side. Okay. And then we'll give him the white of his eye with oyster beige over on this side. Equal. Okay. All right, I tested our glue and it is, look at this, this is just holding awesomely. You could actually paint the edge of the magnet if you wanted it to be red. I've got a little bit of goober in there, but isn't that cute to have that nose hanging off the edge? And it just hangs perfectly straight. That's exactly what I wanted to see. Love the idea of hanging more things on your banners and just doing it with magnets. Not getting the highlight that I wanted on top of his ear. I don't know why I'm stressing about it, but I'm going to switch to Pebble and do it within. I just feel like there needs to be some kind of little attention to that area for whatever reason. Okay, and see that's not even that bright, so I'm going to go back and give it a little bit more. Now we'll work on giving him some little eyelashes. Alright, we're going to attack the bow. We're going to have some maybe I'll start out with cinnamon drop first. Dry rubbing. Okay, let's see if I like it. I don't know if I'm going to like it. I still don't know if I like it. We'll see. So just lots of lots of just rubbing and just nice and big. Start giving that bow some attitude. And now we'll go into Dirty Brush, into the Coral Rouge Blush. And I like what it's doing to this color. It's making it a little bit like a darker pink instead of so bold. Okay, so we'll start getting up the highlights. Notice I use little circles. It's like a stipply, circly motion. Okay, a little bit more down here. We don't want this to become too much, so we have to be careful. Now we're almost all the coral blush. Give it a little bit of a stipply highlight. The reason I'm stippling is because my surface is just a little bit wet. And that is how I can get by with going ahead and layering. One more time. Coral blush. Clean my brush, and then we'll go into the alizarin. And we'll float just right on top of what we've done at the edges. I like the alizarin and the country red combo a lot. Makes a really rich shading color. The alizarin is very, very transparent, so that helps us. And we'll just shade. Notice that my brush is angled and I'm down on my hand. Okay, and so that I can slide this brush where I need it to be. Okay, we'll do it the same way coming this way. Slide on in. Under a ribbon or a bow. It is like frog weather or something. I feel like I'm a frog. Okay, we'll just keep floating and shading. Bring it around the back. The bow. Keep that roundness. And then we'll bring it down the tails. And we'll base in maybe with some deep burgundy. I don't know if that's going to be dark or dead enough looking. Let's give it a test. I don't think so. Let's see. I don't know. I'm going to wait for it to dry. All right, I think I do like this color. Just one wash of it. I'm going to go into Antique Maroon and see if that will give me a shadow. Yeah, that's working. It's really amazing how much more water you have in your brush to float nicely in big areas on rock lawn. So do pay attention to that if you've struggled at all with that. That will help you. So just walk that kind of down on this lower one. Okay. And I picked Antique Maroon because it is just a little bit more of a really subtle color. It's not a screaming red, and yet it doesn't lean real hard to the purple side like the soft black does. Not soft black, black plum. Black plum really screams to the purpley side. And we'll go ahead and deepen some of our shadows around. Okay. Round it up a little bit towards things. Pucker it down. And you won't go everywhere that you went with the first shadow. You'll just choose. You'll choose. Yeah, you'll choose. There you go. Okay. Drag it out just a little bit. When I want to just drag out color, I'm tipping my brush so that just the tip is floating. Okay. It's starting to look bow-like, isn't it? That might almost be enough. I think we'll try dry brushing just a little bit of our coral blush. I'll flatten it in my big number 4. And we'll just leave some streaks on top of the bow. I'm juicy loading the brush and then flicking it on the paper towel. And then let's bring it up next to our edge of things. And then we need to bring it along the bottom, like there's a... Actually, let's bring a little bit lighter, a darker color there. And then kind of connect. Connect up here. So on the upper, we're coral. And let's do some in the bow of the knot. That gives them just a little bit kind of a choppy highlight kind of thing. Let's give them a little bit of movement in the top. Or in the tail, sorry. When I stop making sense, it's because I'm focusing. I've escaped over to the other side of my brain. Okay, just a little bit more up here. And let's go into Cinnamon Drop plus the Coral Blush for this lower area. And give it that kind of highlight down here and that highlight there. And back into Coral Blush for a stronger highlight here. Okay, I think we can dig it. We're going to add some little eyelashes to his little face, okay? And so what we're going to do is we're going to just kind of add him way up here at the top, following along his eye, and kind of having him get shorter. Aren't they cute? Okay, so that's just with thinned lamp black. I can go in and maybe add one more. There, you can make them a little bit heavier. There we go. All right, we're going to take the... Say all right a lot. Let's not have all right. All right, there I go already. So let's try a little bit of our cinnamon drop on our bulb. A little bit more. Okay, and I'm going to have to let this dry. We'll also go ahead and just do our details on our berries, our holly berries. Now that I have red on here, I know kind of where I'm going. And I think we'll add a little dry rub of just the, we'll skip cinnamon drop and go just to the coral blush in the middle. And when I float, that'll clean that up. Okay, now we'll go coral blush on our bulb. Okay, and I think
Let's have all the highlights kind of go up. I don't know that that's correct, but we're just going to pretend. We'll go up into the tip.
All right, and then we'll go into our white with the brush mix of the coral blush. So it'll actually just make it a lighter pink. Okay, and now we'll shade with our Alizarin. And lick to get the red off of our blue color. Once again, I'm a little bit dry, so you gotta make sure that you keep that water in your brush. And can I get over here? So I'm leaning way down to see what I'm doing so I can keep you on camera. Get that out of my highlight. Okay, I'm gonna have to let that dry, but I can come down here and I can make my C strokes on my berries, and we'll add a little dazzling highlight kind of moment. We'll go into our coral blush with our round and add a C stroke, and then we'll go into white and just add a little bit of a shine within that. Okay. Okay, so now on our light bulbs, what we're going to do is we're going to add white, dry brushed star shines. Out of my own way here. Nice and sparkly and nice and white in the middle. And I think I should have waited until I got that a little bit messy. I think I might should wait until I get my little bit of glow going around, so I'll probably have to futz around with that. Let's take our I'm not sure Alizarin what it's going to do on my blue background, but we'll try it. And I am going to wait until that dries so that I don't make a mess. All right, before I get too crazy with all this, the light bulbs and stuff, I got Midnight Blue. I'm making a very, very washy float. And I'm going to go ahead and just at least glaze the sides of my banner. I can bring that in a little bit. Okay, flip it over. See if I can get you on camera this time. Bring it into his neck area, just to darken that. Okay, now it looks like he's, you know, got darkness there because he's got a wreath around his neck. I'm thinking that, let's see, I'm going to want some of this kind of squiggled inside of all this, so we'll just kind of pull this up first. First we'll get that in there, and down here. And what I'm thinking is if we have just a little bit of this darker blue, then what's going to happen is we'll be able to see our sparkles a little bit better. All right, so let's go. And I think I'll switch brushes into an older glaze. So I've got like a half inch or a 3/4 inch, and I'll do a wash. That's what I was hesitating about. I didn't want that blunt line from the floater there. Yeah, that's not gonna make me happy either. Okay, I don't like that. I'm not sure. Okay, here's what we'll do. We're gonna take a mop. I could use retarder. What I want is a glaze. And I don't, you can't get a dry rub glaze. So, yeah, that's not really gonna work either. So we use our fingers. And stay out of our whitest snowflakes. And carry it up, do a little slip slap. I'm liking that color a little bit better. Okay. Now we'll do it dreamy magical, coming around. And then, of course, we'll repeat with white and stuff after we see where we get with our sparkles. Now, in the meantime, our red is dry. So I can't remember what color I said. I think alizarin we were going to try. And I tried putting a little bit of dry brushed glitter in the background. I'm not sure if I'm going to like that either, so I'm going to leave it. So our bulbs are casting red light. So we'll have them have just a little bit of an aura around them. Okay, and I think I can dig that. Now I go back into my white. And I redo the white, because it wouldn't be pink light, it's going to be white light. Okay, so he's got quite a sparkle going on. What I like about that is it a little bit takes away from the fact that it's a red bulb. So I like that there's this big, you know, splashy light. And so it kind of takes away from so much of the red, in theory. Okay, so we're going to continue on. I'm going to finish my red bulbs. And then we'll move into the other color bulbs. Okay, I'm putting the highlights on the holly with white, just little dashes of white instead of the mix. I like it a little bit better, a little bit more obvious. Okay, this is, you see things once you start waiting till the end. You know, you've got, like I did these bulbs and then I did the bow. We could also flatten that brush and as a dry brush and add just a little highlight with white to the bow to de-pinkify it a little bit. Okay, and I think that's kind of cute. It kind of balances out the whites and the reds. Okay, he's getting awfully cute. See how cute those sparkles are up there? I like them. All right, you've got to keep your dry brushes kind of dry, wet, so that, not wet, but you've got to keep them clean so that you can use them, but you don't want to wet them. So sometimes you leave them aside and they get really hard. This guy is dry, it's hard, and it's yucky. And I know I showed you that the brush cleaner works on the acrylic bridge, but I think we need to see just how stinking well it works on these crescent brushes. So this is dry, not leaving any paint. And then you just go in there and it immediately starts releasing the color. And then my brush is flexible. I can scrub it off over here on these points that are quite sharp. Okay, now I'm getting green and yellow, so you can tell my, this is probably something I did when painting pumpkins or something like that, leaves. Okay, so then I get it all nice and look at no color on there now. And what's nice is I can go from that brush. Here I've got one that is very hard, and I can't even flex this guy. I can just go ahead and clean these all at the same time, and I don't waste my product. So here comes the green that we could see. That guy's got layer after layer. I'll bet I get 20 colors out of him. Okay, so I'm using some pretty good pressure just to get that bent in there. You can also leave these to soak overnight. And this is going to be a much better brush once I get done. And I'll have a new pile of paint I can base cut with. There's going to be so much pigment in there. Okay, so I'll get these clean. I'll rinse it out in my water basin, and I'll have my brushes ready for the next time once they dry. All right, we're going to go into Whispering Turquoise, and we're going to do our blue lights. Step a little bit to strengthen. Okay, we'll do that to all the blues, and then we'll go in with our green. Let's see if I can find a brush that is somewhat dry, and we'll go into the Limeade on our green bulbs. Okay, we'll repeat on all the greens. Oh, and I didn't get my light colors out. I'll have to find them. Now with each of them, I want to go ahead with just the lightest color plus white and just give it that little bit more sparkle. So whatever your lightest color is plus white. I could go into just white and go back and do that to our reds. Give it a little bit of a highlight right there in the middle. There we go. Okay, on the yellow ones, or on the orange ones, we're going to use saffron. And follow with white plus saffron. I might have to do that again. Maybe just mix the two of them. You start getting into yellows and oranges and things, and you start having problems with things covering. The transparency issue. And so now I'll just put some white on there, pretty solid. There we go. I'm going to go ahead and add the glow on my orange bulbs with the color persimmon. Outside. And then we'll float with persimmon. Nice big, because we're going to do one more little float, another color. Okay, very good color for this. I like this color persimmon. We'll float over the tops of them. I'm going to float on both sides. I had already shaded the bottoms. If we need to re-put in a little bit of a highlight, we can. Okay, one more smaller float of traditional burnt, the sienna. Just where it's heaviest. So we get the top and the bottom there. Okay, gives it just that really deep glowing kind of look. Okay, we're going to shade the green bulb with, festive green followed by holly green. Alright, so just shade over the top. And what I like about this is that green is going to be visible there because we've changed the temperature and we've changed the basic green family. So, for example, this moves into kind of that kind of olive drab, so we've got a very toned green color. And then this is very much over into the yellow green, which actually the olive drab is kind of the yellow green too, so it's not really a color family change, but it's definitely a temperature getting a little bit more yellow, a little bit more bright, in there so we can see green on green that way. We're going to use the festive green to do our shine. If you're ever looking for brushes to get, and you're looking to make it take advantage of specials, get crescent brushes, because you can use, I think I have 3 or 4 complete sets and I still run out when I'm doing projects like this. And I own the store, you know, that's just silly. Okay, got our shine. Now we'll go in with our holly green and deepen it. Nice. Our blue is going to be shaded with, Midnight Blue? I don't have a repeat color, but you could repeat with Midnight if you needed to. Midnight's pretty strong. Look at that. I like its very transparent color, but it's a great glazing color. I need this to be a fatter little float out here. I may end up repeating it just to fatten it up. Okay, that gives us a pretty blue color. All right, and dry rub. I am wet. So we're going to dry rub outside with the Midnight Blue. And actually, inside the ear right here, we're going to go into Calypso, which was our base coat color. And we are going to dry rub the Calypso color because that dark blue isn't going to even show. And inside the ear would be where the light was going to shine. I mean, you'd see it in that dark, dark place. So we want to make it be a little bit lighter than the other. And then go back to the midnight for your other bulbs. I know my sparkle's kind of all like little soldiers. And so I'm going to do my shine, all one sides of my shine, all at the same time. So I'm going to get on my bridge because I'm going to be running through wet stuff. And I think I have to remove Rudolph's nose. Okay, so I'll make all my shines go in one direction. And then I'll turn my piece and make them going in the other directions. Start where your shine is the shiniest. And you can always beep that color up if you need to. Okay, so now we'll rotate. And then we'll do the ones coming down, and then the short ones in between. And just repeat. To keep my color consistent, I'm going to base the, instead of getting out a gray, which is the color I wanted to go into, I'm going to base all these little sockets with honey brown. And they'll be the same color as the wire, so we'll base the wire as well, which I can't see where my wires go. But that will give us a little bit of uniformity of color. So this is one of those times when, just like when we use a darker color for white, we need to consider the color story that we're actually doing when we're putting it together. All right, then dirty brush, we're going to go into our saffron color. And we're just going to give a skinny little line. I'd probably have to chisel my brush. I'm going to switch to a skinnier brush. Okay, so we'll get just a strong kind of sapphire sparkly line going on here. And we're going to add a sparkle. We don't want it to look too metallic, so don't make it too sparkly. Couple little lines. And I actually think I'm doing this backwards, so I'm going to stop what I'm doing, and I'm going to go into... See, I need a skinny, short, bright brush. Because I want a dry, concentrated float. I'm going to use just the very chisel edge of my brush. And let's see if I can get you down closer. Whoops. Okay, we go right there. Okay, so I want to kind of shade on either side of this. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just give it a little tiny floated line. Very, very dry float. And then on either side of our little guys right here, we'll give it a little flip float kind of deal. Okay, and then we'll give our line of sapphire to show like those like socket things. Okay, and then it'll show also up here. Like it's a cord, you know, it has a little separation. Okay, and the shade for our socket and our edge was the traditional burnt sienna. I don't know if I said that or not. Okay. Alright, I've got a glass cutting board. You can use a self-healing mat as well. And I've got the retractable detail knife. And what's cool about this is even if you have it, if you have it retracted, you're not going to hurt yourself on the knife. But it just pops out there, locks into place. Take the cutting blade off, and then this is a really cool design. You put your finger in, it's got a little finger groove place, and then you just simply drag it along, and then you have good pivot control over the knife as you're cutting. If you've ever used a Zacto knife and had your fingertips get so sore from doing the death grip on them, you'll appreciate this design very, very much. I'm not going to cut out up here, but I'm going to cut out from both of these sides right here and just cut this detail out. And I want to be real careful with this, but what I need to do is I need to paint the flip side of this up here, and I can't paint this without rolling this up or, you know, facing it upside down, and I want this varnished before I do any of that. I want it varnished and dried. That way I can protect the edges, but I want to apply my varnish to the cut edges because that just helps everything lay and be perfect. Okay, here's the beginning of the cutout. And with this one, for whatever reason, the detail knife's not making me as happy as my little pair of scissors. If you get a little pair of really good quality scissors, you can also do the cutouts. I like the detail knife a little bit more when I have small, short edges. When I have the longer edges like this, I think I like the scissor a little better. Okay, here I am with my cutout. I'm going to use my craft mat to death here because I'm just going to roll right onto it. Okay, let me make sure I got everything off that I want off. Erase anything that you don't need. I'm going to roll into matte varnish. Banners look much nicer with matte because they're not distracting in the sunshine. And you'll just roll right off the edge. Nice and flat. And give it at least two coats of thin varnish. Thankfully, the doing the roller applies a very nice even amount of varnish. You don't want it too thick on banners because if you get too thick, the banner will start cracking. So you always want to make sure you keep it nice thin coats for everything that you apply. Okay, and that'll perk up all his colors. Okay, and then I'll flip it over and I'll give a coat to the back when I'm done with the other part. All right, we're going to get our greenery going up here on our over our fold. I'm going to start with my soaked brush. I'm going to go into Plantation Pine. The ornaments are based with the Calypso Blue, the Country Red, and then this is Hauser Medium Green. I've got my fold here, and I think I'm trying to decide if I want to have... greenery all above. I think we're going to try it. Oh, more water. Needs to be kind of fluffy looking. And you get the fluff with the water. Whoops! You get a mess with water. I've got these based so that I can see where they go. and I want to just use that. I want to just kind of stipple over my initial base coat. Thankfully, just one coat won't hurt anybody. Okay, make sure you keep your water consistent. And you bring it up over your fold because you don't want that fold showing. You don't want it showing the, like a blue line up there that would be kind of disturbing to the eye. I'm gonna go into black green while it's wet. And see, it kind of just fades out, a little watercolory looking, because I'm doing it in the wet, so those things are gonna blend together. Okay, and then we'll go ahead, rinse our brush, and put a couple of dry sparkles of the Hauser medium green, which are not going to show, so we'll go into Hauser Light. And these may not show either, and then we'll just change our plan. Okay. And we'll let that dry completely,
and we'll move on.
Alright, I've got that dry. I'm going to put a little bit more of our watery plantation pine. Give it a little bit of fullness, a little softness off the edge of our paint. Okay, next I'll go ahead and base the holly that we know we'll have, and I'll get that up there nice and heavy. I will base our holly, and then, and you want to make sure, be careful, look here, I've got a mess, but the back of my project is here, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to lift this, I'm going to mop up my mess, and be very, very conscious of what you have going on there. Okay, so now I'll let that dry and base my holly and do the holly the same way as we did before. Okay, we're going to highlight our leaves with Hauser Light Green. Okay, and we'll decide which way we want to go here. I get out a little mop here. Just to settle that down just a little bit. And I think I need just a little more water. Is that the recurring theme of this project or what? And I think I've got too big a brush. Actually, what I've got is too big a load on the right size brush. So let's just cinch that down by just adding a little less paint. Much better. Carry that right off the edge because we don't want any kind of weird stalls so that you can tell that it doesn't just flop over, you know what I'm saying? And completely floating backwards. So I don't have to make everybody dizzy doing this. Okay, then we'll float to get next to our edges where we decide we want the edges highlighted. We'll come back to, let's see, that's on that side. So let's come over here and give it a shade against that edge. Into that little V right there, and on the opposite side. most important thing is to hit the edge so that you don't,
and we'll get some over here. Got to hit the edge so that you don't have to try to do it when we dry rub. Just a little V.
Okay, and we'll just continue on with the other guys here.
Sometimes you just have to look for happy spots to highlight in.
And sometimes you can just add water instead of rinsing out your brush and stuff like that. That's something good to know about.
Just dip your brush in the water and blot it, and then you can just re-blend, and you don't have to go through all the effort of always cleaning out your brush, which can sometimes be a drag. We're going to repeat this with limeade, so we don't have to get all the way there the first time out.
Just kind of want to get everything established, like where it's going to be. Okay, this one's going to be a little trickier.
Come back at it from the other angle and
cinch it in.
As I want to have a little bit more control over where the paint is staying, I lean my brush back onto itself, so I like lay it down.
Okay, let's give him a curl here. Get out of the way. To be careful with how you're flopping your finished project around. So do watch and be careful.
I'm making this tip over here needs a little something.
Okay, and I think also over here. I think that's a good start. Alright, while we are on our holly, we're going to dry rub with the second one up from the smallest crescent brush, and we're going to go up where we floated, and we're going to make soft, interesting shapes. So we just are going to draw it into the leaf, and it helps tremendously to structure everything. Like the float just gets you in the corner, and then the dry rub just stretches it all out and makes it pretty and soft and elegant. And I'm kind of using little circular motions. And then I've got this float on probably pretty much the wrong side, so I'm going to extend it out the opposite side if I can. And then I'll float next to that to make it dark. I don't like its position, so I'll just change it. Continue.
Same thing here. I'm not sure which side I had floated, but we're going to change it. Because we can.
Okay, now I'm going to show you. We'll go into the Limeade.
And then we'll go back into there and then give ourselves some of those higher highlights. And if I need to, I'll float on top of those to cinch them into the corner.
Now I won't take the Limeade the whole distance down the leaf because then it'll look like it's just like folded in half. I want it to look like it's like cupped, you know, bent in a little bit.
So I'll draw that out.
So see how they start taking shape. You need enough of the Hauser light green in there to support the Limeade. If you don't have enough of it and you go past it, it'll look chalky on your dark green because it's too big of a leap. They say that you want to do your value jumps in the magic number of twos. So if my plantation pine is, say, a dark level of, say, like a 3, and my Limeade is an 8, I can't go from a 3 to an 8. I have to have something in the middle. So that's where the Hauser light green comes in, as it's my steps to get up to the highest highlight that I want. And the Limeade is a step to get up to the lightest light that I'm going to get, including Limeade itself. So I can sneak in with Limeade and then reinforce like you just saw me do. And they call it the rule of two, I think is what it's called. And it's like a bridge going over a river, like one of those board bridges. And if you try to skip too many steps at the same time, then you fall in and you die in the river. So we don't want anybody's projects falling down. So try to remember the rule of two. Okay, and now I'm just going to finish the others just like I did over here. Alright, I'm going to go in with some black green. And I'm going to cinch in the tips where I want them shaded. Okay, this guy isn't over that guy, so we'll give him a little shadow. Okay, and that just helps keep everybody kind of separated and behaving. Reload, water is needed. Okay, and then this guy right over here is behind this ornament. And so we'll cinch him in nicely. And he's also behind on this side. Stroke it in a kind of an oval like that, or a rounded stroke. Stay out of your highlights where possible, and stay on your project where possible. Housers. The best mops in the world are your fingers. Oops. And I repeat. And saliva. Who can do without their saliva cleaning up their mess? Okay, one more leaf. Actually, I think two more leaves. And it comes in together. Now I'm looking at the difference between these leaves and these leaves. And I'm trying to see if I think I might have gotten just a little carried away with my lights. So I'm going to go back into some plantation pine and give myself just a little bit of a settling effect on some of these. So I'll go back over here, just kind of glaze it a little bit. By just floating across that, I'm greening it up just a little bit. I think that's a little bit better. So, there is no such thing as painting something perfect. It's a matter of just painting it till you like it, and then it is perfect. You know, so sometimes we worry about rules and stuff, and it's not really the rules we need to worry about as much as it is getting it to the place where we think that it's awesome. So, you know, I did those leaves and I spent that time, but I didn't care for it, so I futz with it until I like it. I think futzing is highly underrated. Okay, so in some cases I'm just glazing them down completely, I think in almost all cases. Okay, I like that better. And then we take our round brush, wherever it may be, and we go into our limeade, and that's where we put our highlights on. So we just do a little skip highlight, little V highlights. Okay, and that's our sparkles. All right, we're going to take Whispering Pine and we're going to dry rub on our blue ornament. We're going to keep it in the upper, what is this, right corner. And we're just going to rub in ever widening circles. And we can repeat this. So the Whispering Pine is going to be our high highlight, then this is going to be our middle color, and then we're going to have dark here on the edge. Okay, we got to be careful. We don't want to get, if it's wet, we want to not interfere with stuff. We don't want to go through it and then have accidents or holes dug. Keep it all the way over to that side. All right, wash that out. We'll move into our red color with hopefully brushes that are dry. And we'll go into red with the, we're going to do cinnamon drop first. Squish, squish. Cinnamon drop will do more in the middle. It's hard to see probably on camera, but I definitely think that this is worth the step. It just changes the color ever so much. Our green with our brush that is definitely not dry. This is why you need several of these. Let's see if I have another big one. And let's see if this one's big enough. So then the green will go into the Hauser light green. And then this one we're going to keep over to this side. Keeping our focus kind of towards the center. If I put bing, 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 your eye would kind of skip out of the scene. So we want to not have our eye skip out of the scene. Now we'll go into coral blush for the red. Well, my brush is dirty, I didn't wash it out. Shouldn't have washed the blue one out, I guess. However, that's when you need to rely on your brush cleaner and restorer, because then your brushes get all dry. Okay, so we're gonna go back here. This is kind of dirty brush, so it's got the red in it, which means it's gonna take on the color of the other. If I wanted to be able to move into the colors quickly, I could just blow dry. And it's got a little bit of a kind of a cold and a sheen to it. So I think I'm going to have to stop and hit the blow dryer. So to build that one more time. Okay, and then we'll go back to our green. That feels okay. Ever widening rub. I'm going to get it towards that middle. A little bit more. Okay. Another dry spot here. Okay, hit the blow dryer. Going to go into Limeade. With my dirty green brush, and we'll keep that highlight within that green highlight, and we're going to plunk a great big old sparkle over there too, so at least I think we are. Okay, so it's getting shiny. This is really going to change once we get the shadowing done. Stronger highlight. Now we can almost start going like in a line down. A bit more Limeade. Okay. It's getting nice and shiny. Now we'll go into coral blush. And I'll neutralize that so that I get a little bit more pure coral blush. Okay, and I think we're pretty dry. So we're going to come up here. I am just not getting the color I want here. Okay, that's better. I think we'll go coral blush plus a little bit of white. Getting a little bit better. I can see stuff now. And maybe just a little bit more white. can go into the green one, and we can go into a little bit more of our limeade. Build that center, and I think we'll go limeade plus white. Okay, I like that. I can find one more brush. We'll go into the Whispering Turquoise and build an even brighter set of highlights over here. And then we'll go turquoise, Whispering Turquoise plus white. Okay, I think that's balanced, and we'll let that just dry. All right, so we're going to go ahead and shade the red ornament with Alizarin Crimson. Okay, so, oops, itchy leg. You can tell by the mower, it's summertime, and skeeters have been having lunch up me. Okay, here we go. So we're going to shade, and we're going to cup around like that's on top. Okay, and that just starts giving it shape and form. I'm going to make sure I have plenty of water in my brush. And I need a really big float. And this is where things get tricky because I have to keep moving things around. But you can't paint pretty if you don't change the angle of your project. So make sure that you are flipping things over to be able to get it real pretty. Can't see where you're painting, then you're not going to paint it right. Okay, then we'll do that bottom little rim. And repeat on the other side. And I'll wait till that's dry before I do that underneath. I'll do the same thing with Midnight Blue on the blue ornament. If you need a little help getting the floats big, you can always go ahead and put some extender on your project. Okay, now I'm going to skip this area up here because I'm going to have to treat it a little bit differently. All the way next to your edge. Something's not blended. Drag it down from the top, and I'll get into that and blend it a little bit better. And somewhere I had a little mop. There we go. Come over here, and I'm going to shade around this under this leaf and round it out, and then mop. Very light touch. All right, next it's time to do the green. Let's see if I can get you on camera. temper my bridge. I've got Rudolph all rolled up over here. I don't want to smash him flat and crease him, so. All right.
Keep off your leaves. Mop action there. Roll it around and rinse and repeat. Curving that shadow area. Okay, I think this one may have to even out with a little bit of dry rub action.
Okay, now it's time to go back to the red and deepen it.
And I've got out some antique maroon. Let's see if that's going to be dark enough.
Okay, I think that's getting there. And I think once we get our big dark shadow on there, I think we'll be right about there. Okay, we're gonna repeat with the blue. I have dirty floating water. Let's deepen this just a little bit more. Especially on that distant side.
A little bit richer color.
And then we'll do the same with the green ornament. Repeat with the green over here. And that one side just needs to be really deeply shaded. Oh, that's not going to work, is it? We can go one up with the green, but I think we're probably at a standstill with the blue. So I'll hit the blow dryer and I'll be back. Okay, I'm going to dry rub with the holly green to bring that green in a little bit further. And then I think we'll go into the black green. No, I think that's plantation pine. Get some black green out. Whoa, that black green is dark. Okay, am I done with this? Whoops! Hello! Okay, that's what spit and fingers are for. Let's go ahead and float with the black green just right next to that far dark edge. So that's getting nice and dark. I'll get underneath where this plant is coming over. Give it some depth. And then we'll give it a little blaze of this black over here. Well, I thought I didn't have a color that would be darker without going to black, but I've got Payne's Gray out, and I think that's going to be a great color. It goes and leans to the purples. However, for shadows, purples can be a very good thing. It's going to be just right, I think. Okay, then we'll go grab. Make sure you wipe off your mop every time you use it on a wet spot on your paper towel, and then dry it with the dry spot, and then your mop will be ready to use all over the place. So we'll bring this up here. A little bit under, and a little bit down here. And mop, mop, mop. It's the only kind of mopping I like to do. Okay, and then what I have to decide, I think I'm going to bring the darks in just a little bit. So we'll dry rub with the black green. Over on the far side. Okay, so it's giving a really good okay, and then we're gonna do the same with the blue, but I've gotta let that dry. And I've gotta finish my shading underneath the red. So we'll go into the antique maroon. And repeat on the other side. Okay, now in the meantime, let's go ahead and get shading on the berries. They're a repeat as well of the and actually, we didn't do that way. We went into our highlight first. So we'll go into our coral rose. I'm going to skip I'm going to skip cinnamon drop, go into coral rose, because there's no space for that kind of transition. And we'll keep our highlights going to the same side as the other. And we'll just give them all a highlight. Okay, and then we'll go in with our shadow. Oops, and our shadow just got totally blended on both sides. So flip it around. And then we'll do our shadow. And flip it over and do the other side. Where they go on top of each other, make sure you shade underneath. All right, we're going to go ahead and give highlights. Little white, crispy little highlights. Alright, we're going to use some white, and we're going to give everybody a little bit of a white focus. Repeat. get you in a little closer. And it's time to start decorating some of these little guys. So we're going to use the tiniest crescent brush.
And we're going to highlight
with butterscotch.
And the highlight is just a little dry rub kind of thing going there. Not too much work about it.
Then we'll repeat. We'll flatten our short round, so this is a number two easy stroke round.
And then we'll give it a little bit of a glaze in there. Okay.
Actually, I'm thinking we could probably skip the first step. Let me try that.
Oops. Yeah, I think we can skip that. The dry rub. We'll just do the dry brush with the saffron yellow. Saffron. Okay, and we'll do all those, and then we'll do some shading.
All right, we're going to shade using a short bright. See how much shorter this little flat is? That is going to give us a really precise little float. We're going to use very little water with it. And what we're going to do is we're going to shade on both sides of our, we'll do a C-stroke on both sides of our little beads here. Okay, and then we'll put our highlight on. We're almost there. All right, we're going to add the little highlight for the shine. And we're going to add the stars like we had above on our ornaments. These will need to be a little bit bigger. Okay, let's get organized here. Okay, and I might do just a little bit more of the white rubbed in there. We'll see. Okay, and I'll get the rest of the shines on. All right, we're going to put just a little bit of highlight with the saffron yellow on our, stay out of your white, on our little holder here. Okay, and I don't even have that one base coated. Just to give it a little hint, we'll take and flatten our brush and go into burnt sienna, yeah, traditional burnt sienna, and then just give it a little shade on each side on the top. I just want to give that hint of color back there, and then of course we'll scribble this guy in here. Flatten our brush, give them just a little bit of that coloring so we keep going, keep in mind what's going on. Okay, so now I'm going to cut around the ornaments and we're going to see what we see. I think I've decided that I want to have my my light bulbs glittery. So I'm going to just put a coat of, and if I go over my white, I'll just rebase it. You would obviously do your white after this. And I've got my coat of varnish already on it, which is the right way to do varnish. You want to put the glitter on over the top of the varnish. Yeah, that's really going to jazz things up. What I like about these paints is they're just very transparent, and so they just are going to add that sizzle. So I'm going to use neon blue and tiger orange for the orange one. And when I store these, I store them on their heads so that the good stuff, all the glittery stuff, goes to the top of the bottle. We'll go into our orange.
same exact thing. And I think I'll go ahead and give that like two coats. Give everybody a little bit of a kiss of sparkles.
Oh yeah, that's perfect. That's just the right amount of glamour.
You know, sometimes I am such a slow learner.
So I've got my project and I'm doing my thing and putting all the glitter on these, and I'm running my arm through the glitter and smearing it around, and I'm sitting there looking at my bridge. And it's, yeah.
So make sure you use the tools that you have sitting around you, and put the ones that you forget to use kind of close to your workstation so that you remember to pick them up and use them. And then it'll be second nature after not very much time.
Okay, I'm going to use my pop top. These come plain plastic colors, and then you can paint them and give them as gifts. And what I love about them is they just nick the little plastic here, and then it makes it so that I can tear it off. And it doesn't hurt my thumb when I have to open them. Now, I'm not sure if I want to use the orange or the yellow. So I've got lemon drop and I've got tiger orange. And I'm not certain which one I'm going to like better. So I'm going to go ahead and I've got them both out. And I want to do these beads. I think that they would be nice jazzed up. So let's try one with yellow. And we'll try one with the orange. And we'll see what we see after they're dry. Okay, I think I'm definitely going to like the orange, so I'm just going to go with Tiger Lily and make them all so, and I'm going to wipe off the yellow. Yellow just got too light. I like the warmness of the orange. And I'll just do all these little beads. Okay, the reason I like these magnets is because this is a very heavy topper. I mean, like this is a solid wooden nose, and they have attached themselves to my scissors. And see how it's not going anywhere? If you have a weaker magnet, then you'll get like wimpy kind of sliding down your banner and stuff. So these magnets, super duper 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 strong. You can't even take them apart. All right, we're going to work on our little banner now. I've got two toppers that I'm doing because I want to have an alternate saying. I think it's just going to be too much fun. Alright, I'll spit out my colors, and this will just kind of go fast. Just want to dry rub. We're going to use these ginormous dome brushes to get the dry rubbing look. Okay, we don't have to worry about being too fussy. So what we're going to do is we're going to go into our honey brown, dry off in the paper towel. In big, long movements with your arm, you're just going to streak that, trying not to make stop and start points. Build it up. Good streaks are awesome. That's going to add to our wood grain. See what I did there? Shame, shame, shame. So we'll try rubbing less and streaking more. And I'll wait until those dry. And so I'm just rubbing off just a little bit. We'll just streak right on through those. And that'll just add to our wood grain. Sure you pay attention to the lower area. Then you move down into the other color. So lighter, lighter, lighter. So it goes honey, brown, cocoa, and then camel. And you'll brighten up what you've done. Ooh, you see that? Not a problem. this will be the accent color. That's the camel. And we can go back into, we can go backwards into some of the colors. Okay, I went back to my first one. I'm gonna, whoops, blot that out a little bit stronger. Want to get it coming in from the edge just a little bit better. Like the edges of my signs are a little aged. Not everywhere. And I'm gonna make sure to get above the fold. Okay. Just a couple more streaks. Make sure I get... All right. Okay, we're going to thin our camel with our filthy water. And we're going to use our rake, and we're going to splay it out. This is a half-inch White Wonder rake. I use it for all of my spattering and my big rake jobs. Okay, so then what we're going to do is we're going to just, moving from like the arm, you want to create these streaks. I'll go into a little bit with camel as well. Okay, give it that kind of dried board look. Only let the toe sit down. If you let the whole brush lay down, then you'll be base coating. You can make some of them start moving like boards. So I can bring it down and go up and over and create a little bit of wood grain. Okay, we're going to get our wet milk chocolate and put in a little bit of black with it and float. Okay, so what we want to do is we're going to create our boards. We basically have like three planks here. And we're going to kind of glaze over things and begin the float process to establish the boards. I'll go back into more just the milk chocolate. So warm it up first, and then we'll cool it down with the black. Make sure you keep your distance equal, or that you can see. Like, I just kind of stabbed at that and I couldn't really see because of glare. And you want a balanced boards, kind of. Don't do a bunch on one side and not do a bunch on the other. Okay, so that's boards. And you can kind of just even go through and just streak it if you want. Keeping in mind that we have, Rudolph is very brown, and he's a really warm brown, so this can be a warm brown as well. And we'll go into add our cracks on our boards with just black. Okay, so we'll go here and just establish the board. Go here. We'll bring that down just a little bit. Okay, yeah, I like that they're kind of uneven. I like that it looks like somebody grabbed, you know, three things laying on the ground. I'm floating down the other side now. I'm making a mess. Okay, now we want to take the same thing and we want to make some of our cracks at the ends of things. So we'll just sideware. And you want them different lengths, so don't, like this one right here maybe could be longer, like it's coming into the board. Okay, you don't want everybody to be the same because then it's going to look fake and wrong. And they'll also line up, you don't want them to line up. Okay, same thing down here. You can make it be a little bit heavier at the front end. And one can be really small, like it's just starting. And then we can come in here and we can add some float for like a knot. And here we've got a little area we can. Knots frequently have, what do you call them, cracks coming out of them. Okay, and now we'll make some just general with green. It always amazes me how fast this comes together. You know, it's just suddenly, hello, now I'm a plank. You know, and 2 minutes ago it was, you know, a plane. So, yeah, that's just fun. Okay. All right, we're going to spatter with thinned lamp black. So add to some of our just aged patina. Okay. And then we can trace on our pattern. All right, so as I'm laying, let's get this guy up here. As I'm laying this with this, I love taking the opportunity to show you what I know when I see it. Okay, when we lay this with this, let me get you on camera as much as possible. See how Rudolph is very, his highlights are very kind of cool looking. And then see how this is kind of very yellow looking. Okay, we have a little bit of a conflict going. I want them to be more like family members. So I'm going to go into Pebble. And I'm going to just diffuse some of that yellow. It's almost like putting makeup on. Okay, so you just see something you don't like. And you just tone it on down. Okay, and that'll make him feel a little bit more like it belongs to this story. Okay, let me double check it over here. And yeah, we could also bring in a little bit of our espresso because while his highlights are cool, his he's definitely a warm brown kind of little dude. So we'll go into espresso and we'll streak in a little bit of that in our browns. Okay, I think that is a little bit more like it belongs to that story. Okay, I've got country red lettering, and I'll go back and patch that. And if I can find my brush, we're at the time of the project when everything, I threw it across the table, everything's a mess. So I've got the plantation pine. It's just a complete repeat of what we did on the other holly. I'm not going to show it again because it's exactly the same. Okay, we'll do some drop shadowing with our black, and we'll thin that so it flows nicely. Okay, and so what we'll do with the drop shadowing is we'll do it all on the same sides. I need a little bit more flow. Okay, so when things curl, you do it a little bit on whatever side is facing the side that you've decided to drop shadow. Okay, and that just really makes the letters pop out. All right, we're going to do our cord with some saffron. So I've got it based in the, that color. Looks like that's milk chocolate, which I think is the wrong color actually, but we'll make it work. And then we'll just staccato some of the saffron yellow on it. Okay, since that's solid, we'll go solid there. Just to give us that look of... And have it heavy on your brush. You're going to have to probably repeat it. And we'll give our little bulbs their little deals. And then go back and repeat it all. It's going to stand out. Okay, that is the wrong color because I had honey brown on this other one. This is looking a little too dark with my saffron. So what I'll do is I'll go back over, let some of that other show through, and fix it. Just a quick little fix here. And then the saffron will look a little bit nicer. All right, I'm going to take my short bright and I'm going to float with Alizarin Crimson up the bottom of my letters. And I'm just walking that float up. Very little water. Okay, that starts giving the letters some depth. And then you'll do, and I'm doing this instead of dry, instead of doing a dry brush because I want it to be a wash. That alizarin just really adds a richness, but it won't add the richness if it's just dragged up. All right, we're going to take our round brush and we're going to flatten it into coral, whatever its name is, coral blush. You know, these labels on top of these paint bottles are so handy because when you're looking at the body of paints, you don't have to twist them to see, you know, what each paint is so that you can easily tell. And generally speaking, what I do is I arrange my colors, and mine are all out of sorts, but I'll arrange my colors in color families. And see, look at, here's alizarin without its label on it. Okay, so you want to make sure you get some labels on there, you arrange them by family, and then it's much easier to paint. Anyway, we're flattening into coral blush, and then we're going to just dry brush from the top down on all the letters. And I guess we'll go ahead and give this a little bit of a ha-cha-cha over there. If you get onto your black, don't worry about it. Just go back and fix it. And I think we'll go into a little bit of white, if I can see anything. I've got glasses on for close-up. And there it is. And I can't read the labels. So it doesn't matter anyway. I can't read the labels because I'm blind. All right, dirty brush into some white. And then let's go ahead and just kind of do like a little bit of a kind of a stroke on top. Stroke to the side. And give it a little punctuation. Kind of like that. Yeah. It's just enough jazz. Alright, now we'll go ahead and we'll get a little closer. And we'll go into our deep burgundy. And then just darken the very bottom of these letters, not with a float, but just with a dry brush. Should probably switch to a bigger brush. Kind of dry paint. And then just flick up. Easy cheesy. All right, so we're going to paint. the halls and the red bulb with the red glitter, Glamour Dust Paints. Okay, so we'll just go ahead and get those all glitterified. I think I don't want the deck, though, to be glitterified. I think that's too much glitterification. So I think this will be enough. Well, but I'll probably do two coats. I probably will only do one coat at the top because I don't want those highlights to get too pink. They're already a little bit pink. I may have to put them back on. I could switch to the clear glitter for up there after I put them back on. Alright, so I think that's going to look real jazzy. Okay, we've got to smear the light bulb stuff. You want to make sure that you're that you work from the back. Let's see. You want to do this before you do the glitter on your letters, like I just did, right? I always seem to have good advice, but that I never take. Okay, so we're going to make our glow go around. And actually, I guess I can get that glow on the letters because they are going to be affected by that. I don't think I like it on the letters. Okay, so we'll just go back into our glitter. Actually, we'll go into a little bit of the white. Get that highlight on there. Go back into the red. Work our way back a little bit. There we go. And then I'll just redo our black. Okay, I'm going to try out some of these little wood flourishes on there. I'm going to go ahead and just kind of stipple straight up and down and then not do too much harassing of my edges on this. I'm using honey brown. And it'll look a little bit like the edges are shaded. Kind of stipple them a little bit. There we go. And there we go. And allow that to dry. Alright, we'll go ahead and shade, or highlight rather, on our leaves. Just the same exact technique as we did before, just to give them a little bit of detail. We're going to run a line up the middle of our swirly bit with the saffron to give it that little bit of sparkle. Real strong, real chisely. And then we're going to shade with just a little bit of that color. Not espresso, not antique maroon, where are you? Okay, it's traditional burnt sienna, and I think my bottle knocked over. Okay, so I'm just going to run a little skinny float along one side, kind of here and there. To give it a little bit more dimension. Yeah. And then you can re-add the other highlight back on top if you need to. Yeah, that could be kind of fun. Let's try that. Let's do a series of little just dot sequences. Cute. All right, to attach my banner to this and keep it so it doesn't slide, I've got sticky Velcro on there, and I've taken the tab off the bottom one, I'll get that lined up exactly the way I want it, and then I will stick that down and it'll be exactly lined up. And then I will hot glue my little embellishments on there. Make sure you give a little foundation for those little leaves so that they don't break off. I think that just adds that little bit more jazz moment to it. And I'm debating about adding snow. Let's talk about snow for a second. This is Glistening White Snow Rider, and it's been sitting up in a very hot building, so I don't know if I'm going to have a plug tip or if it's going to just work real nice for me. There we go. Great. Okay, so it seems to me that if we had a little bit of snow kind of drooping here and there, I think that's just going to add just a little bit more jazziness. So run it along the edge and then kind of swirl and scoop it down. Point it to where you want it to be, where you want the attention to go. And then you'll want to also put some on the tip, on the top of the thing. And we can have some of it coming out of the letters. Okay, and I think I'll put some on these as well, but let me get them glued on first. Okay, we'll get some on. A little bit on our guy right there. And where else? I think I want to have some dripping down on Rudolph's how easy is this for applying snow? This is just easy, easy, easy. And the neat thing is I'm on my nonstick craft mat, so it also will not stick. And so I think Rudolph's antlers need a little bit of love. Let me see if I'm making a mess here. And see if I can get you on camera. Okay, so I think we'll bring a little bit of snow. Right off the edge there. Who says that antlers have to be, or Rudolph's have to be inside there out playing in the snow? Says the fenders have to be flat. Yeah, that's just kind of cute. Okay, and I'm wanting some someplace else too. Wonder if we want some on his ear. Like it's plopping down from above. I like it. All right, we have got quite a project here. This is Deck the Halls, and this is our Rudolph with an actual magnetic on nose. Okay, there's a magnet on the backside that you can stick wood pieces onto your banner with. This has got a velcroed on upper flap. Okay, so we've got this hanging over down here, and we've got it cut out at the bottom as well. We've got snow, glistening snow rider, sprinkled on our topper on the top and from our letters and from his antlers, and it's just really three-dimensional. We've also taken advantage, maybe scooch you down a little bit, we've taken advantage of our new embellishments and we've embellished both sides as well. We've got the glitter paints. I think this is just so festive. I think that the colors are festive. Everything to me is just, this is just a sparkly, awesome deck the halls kind of project. So I hope that you enjoy it. It's certainly, I don't know, it's just fun.